Dave Mad Max 6, we are back at the Mecca, and I have my very pretty friend, Sheena Martin. And Sheena, you have some new blood here for us today from your country, from your home country, and you actually told me a little bit about Ephraim right here. So I'm going to let you introduce him real quick and tell me why he's here and who he is a little bit, real quick.
So I am the first New Zealander to make it onto Jay Cutler's YouTube channel.
Very true.
Here we have the second. Well, as you guys know, I'm from New Zealand. I moved to America chasing my dreams in the IFBB and in the sports. And recently I saw through social media that Ephraim had won his IFBB Pro card. And he is the first IFBB Pro wheelchair bodybuilder from New Zealand. So I reached out to congratulate him because I thought it was pretty awesome. And he told me that he was coming to LA. And I thought it would be pretty awesome if I could get him to get his story on Jay Cutler's YouTube channel so that he could share it a bit further and wider.
And we love you for that. Ephraim, welcome to California. Welcome to Gold's Gym, my friend.
Thank you.
You look very young. How old are you?
So I'm 26, turning 27 in about 3 months.
So 26 now. Years old. Yeah. And you just started bodybuilding 2 years ago.
2 years ago, back in 2017.
Wow.
Yeah, so it hasn't been long.
Wow. So you get a great story. We're going to get in there. We're going to do a little bit of training. We're going to sit afterwards and you're going to tell us your story, which is very inspiring. I think it's going to be really, really good for our viewers to see that. And I really appreciate you coming to Gold Gym. And Sheena, thank you so much for introducing us, Ephraim. All right, let's get in there.
Hi guys, so we're here at the Mecca with Ephraim Gudgeon, all the way from New Zealand, and you get a great story, man, and you look great, and you said you were here in the States for about a week, and you ate a lot of good food, but you still look in really good shape to me, so it must have not been that bad.
Oh, it was bad to me.
It wasn't bad to you.
Thank you.
Well, if you go on vacation and you don't let yourself go a little bit, it's not a real vacation.
Yeah.
So, I want to hear about your story because it's very inspiring, I think. You are 26 years old and you were not always in a wheelchair. That's a big question that I had. You know, some people, you know, are born this way. This is something that that happened not so long ago. So tell me, you know, what happened and, you know.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah, so lots of people when they first meet me, they think, oh, this guy's been in a wheelchair all his life. But as you said, it wasn't always that way. Probably about just over two years ago now, back in 2017, I was, me and my family, my wife, we were swimming at a waterfall or water hole back home in New Zealand. And just being the young kind of adrenaline junkie I was, I decided, silly thinking, I decided to jump off the waterfall into the water hole, which I did. And pretty much when I hit the water, couldn't feel my legs, couldn't feel anything from my waist down pretty much as soon as I hit the water. So when I hit the water, I couldn't feel anything and my back was in pain. I tried to call for help, but over the waterfall no one could really hear me, so I just had to kind of suck it up and swim to the side. Once I got to the side of the water hole, everyone realized something was wrong, and I pretty much had to get airlifted to hospital where I had to have surgery. And the doctors told me I had fractured my T12 vertebrae, which had left me paralyzed from the waist down, and I had damaged my spinal cord. So the spinal cord is pretty much a extension of the brain. It's responsible for sending the messages from the brain to the rest of your body. So I damaged the part of the spinal cord that's responsible for sending the messages to my legs. Doctors told me that I pretty much wouldn't be able to walk again for the rest of my life, which was kind of hard, but with the help, especially for my wife and the rest of my family, I was able to push through that phase of my life. I think I was in hospital for about 3 months. As soon as I got out, I just kind of wanted to stay active, which kind of brings me to the gym and living a kind of healthy lifestyle.
So did you hit rocks? Is that what happened?
No, I didn't hit anything. I just hit water. So
really?
Yeah, I did. I just hit the water, I guess.
Wow.
From being at such a high height.
Oh,
on,
I see.
On Google, it says it was probably about maybe 20 to 30 meters. High. So if something from that high when you hit the water, it just felt like concrete, really. Just felt like
I hit rock. Well, that could happen to anybody because you see people doing that all the time.
You don't realize until it happens to you, you know, that it can happen to anyone. So yeah, it's a bit of a wake-up call and for me and my family. Yeah.
So you were how old, 24 when that happened?
23, yeah, I was about 23, 24 years old, I think it was.
And how do you pull yourself mentally out? You must have, because you were a swimmer, right?
Yeah.
Before.
So, yeah, so I was a swimmer back in my teen years. I think I started swimming when I was about 8 years old, and then competitive swimming when I was about 9 years old.
Wow.
And I represented my region or state, as people call it here in the US. My state represented my region at the New Zealand Nationals. So,
wow.
I've always been involved in sport at an early age, but nothing at a world elite level.
Well, you were good though.
Yeah, I was all right, I guess. Yeah.
He's so humble too. I love it. So how do you, because I'm very interested in this, you know, psyche side of things. When someone is so active and an athlete, you know, his whole life, and something like that happens to you, how do you not fall in a deep, deep depression and just want to quit? Instead, you go the other way and you're like, you know what, I'm going to take on bodybuilding instead.
Yeah. Don't get me wrong, I did go through a phase. It wasn't a long phase. It's probably maybe about a month max, where I kind of felt like...
sorry for yourself.
Sorry for myself. And yeah, I guess you could say felt a little bit depressed and like life... I never ever felt that life was over though. I guess it just coming from a family, a father who taught me to work hard my whole life. I never felt that life was over or that I wouldn't be able to still have goals and dreams and achieve those dreams.
Wow.
It was more of the fact that life would be a little bit different from now on. So wow. I never thought that life was over, I just knew that life was going to be different. Once I got over that mindset, I kind of just worked towards whatever goals I had. So probably for about a month, I think for a good solid month, I cried pretty much every night in hospital. When my wife would leave me or when my family would leave the room, that's when I kind of felt really alone and down, and that's when I kind of let it all out. I tried not to let my family see that, but I think the thing that made me pull through it was just a good support system, especially for my wife. She's been with me pretty much since day one. We were only married for about 6 months at the time of my accident, and she's been with me ever since. And probably that support system, if I could narrow it down to one thing that got me through that phase, it would be a good support system through my wife and my family that kind of helped me realize that life wasn't over, it would just be different from now on.
You found a good wife.
Yeah, she's...
she's a keeper.
Good so far, that's for sure. Yeah, she's been good to me.
I don't know if everybody would have said, man, I hate to say that, but some people, it's a lot to take, you know?
Yeah,
you're 6 months married to someone and, you know, wow.
Yeah. I've heard a lot of people, even in people with the same injuries as me that I was in hospital with, they had relationship problems where their partners would... they'd leave them, and it was quite sad to see.
Yeah, they get sick or something.
I've been really, really lucky. Yeah, been blessed.
Well, you seem like a good person, so I'm sure she knows that too. And
Thank
you know, it's not easy to find good people. You know,
So
tell me about bodybuilding. When does the idea of becoming a professional bodybuilder, or even take on bodybuilding without even becoming a pro, creep into your head? How did that happen?
To be honest, I never ever thought that I would be a pro bodybuilder. Even it wasn't until maybe about 3-4 months ago that's when I kind of thought, okay, maybe I could become
really?
A bodybuilder. No, it's never been on my mind to become a professional bodybuilder and to make it make a career out of it. Before my accident, I was always involved in the gym and training and stuff like that. I had always followed bodybuilding but never had thought to get into it.
I know, that's what happened at Gold's in Venice, yeah.
Yeah, so I never really thought about getting into it until the time of my accident. I was in hospital just scrolling through my social media news feed, and then I came across wheelchair bodybuilding. I saw that they had it at the Arnold Classics.
Yes.
Once I saw that, I kind of, it was game over after that. I knew pretty much from that point on that was what I wanted to do. Before my accident, I was always into kind of fashion and having the best kind of gears and label clothing. So in a wheelchair, you can't really look that good wearing clothes. So I thought, if I can't look good wearing clothes in a wheelchair, then I'll look good
naked.
Yeah, wearing no clothes. So I was like, oh, okay, that's me. Oh, that's what I want to do. So I had my accident in February. Got out of hospital in about April. And pretty much the day after getting out of hospital, I went to my local gym. The gym was upstairs, and I just pretty much told my wife, take my wheelchair up the stairs, I'll meet you there. So I just kind of had to one step at a time lift up the chair, and then from that point on, I just kind of trained for the New Zealand Wheelchair Bodybuilding Nationals, which was that same year in November. So from April to November, I trained up hard into the Nationals and ended up winning that competition.
Wow.
A year later, I entered the NABA regional competition. I was the only wheelchair athlete for my region to enter, so I guess you could say I won that. And then about maybe February this year, I saw a poster on Facebook, or a notification came up saying that the Toronto Pro would have its
wheelchair division.
Yeah, wheelchair division, and it was open to anyone around the world could enter it. And so I told my wife, okay, this would be cool if I'd done this. And at the time, I thought I wouldn't be able to enter just due to money. Flying from New Zealand to Canada is not cheap. I actually didn't think I could win it, to be honest. I was like, oh man, it's an international competition, it's not just New Zealand.
Yeah.
And so my wife was the one who kind of pushed me to do it. She said, nah, you should do it just for the experience. And in my mind, I didn't want to do it for the experience. I'm going to do something, I want to win it.
Of course.
And flying all that way, I didn't want to waste all that money just to have a good experience. If I was going to do it to win it. And so she said, okay, think about it for maybe about a day or two, and then we'll see where we go. So after maybe a day later, I decided, okay, I'm going to do it. If I'm going to do it, I want to win it. So I just trained from about maybe February all the way up until the end of May. We saved up every penny that we could get, and flew to Toronto, and I ended up winning the amateur division and won my pro card there, which was a huge blessing. So yeah, back to your question, man, I never ever thought I'd be a pro bodybuilder until I saw that Toronto Pro wheelchair division.
This just happened. You saw your brand new pro just a few months ago, huh? What month was it?
It was May 31st.
Yeah.
That was the competition. Yeah.
So 2 months, couple months.
Yeah, so it hasn't been long. And wow. Yeah.
So how does it feel to be an IFBB Pro wheelchair guy?
It feels awesome, man. Yes. Like I said, I knew if I trained hard enough, with the mindset of going there to win, that I could win it. But it wasn't until I was there and saw all the rest of the competition, without sounding like a fat head, before we even went on stage, I kind of knew I had it in the bag.
Really?
Yeah, it was
nice.
It was a surreal experience. I was blown away. Not only by the win, but just the experience of it all was just really, really amazing. Back home in New Zealand, we have nothing like that.
I was going to ask you, is there a lot in your country or your surrounding countries of wheelchair competition, or do you have to travel a lot worldwide to be able to compete now?
Yes.
I know the Arnold has it, right?
Yeah, the Arnold has it. So back home in New Zealand, for pros anyway, there's nothing back home for
okay.
For the pro wheelchair.
Okay.
Just for amateurs. And then as far as Australia is concerned, I don't even think they have anything there. Not for the pros anyway. So in order to compete from now on, really, I have to come to America. I think America's the only place for pro wheelchairs.
Yeah.
They have it at the Toronto Pro, the Dallas Yopa, the Arnolds, and I think there's about three or four of them.
That's good.
But from New Zealand, it takes a lot of money to come all the way here.
I know. So I was going to bring me to the next question. Do you actually have any sponsor who approached you to sponsor you or anything like that yet?
No, I don't have any sponsors.
Maybe you will after this.
Maybe. We'll see what happens. I am with EHP Labs, not as an athlete. I'm just what they call an all-star.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's more of a small thing.
An ambassador?
An ambassador. That's what it is, really. Which I'm grateful for.
Yeah.
I really am grateful for. But I guess if you want to make it in this sport, you kind of have to
traveling and all that
stuff.
That's what costs a lot of money.
It's not cheap, man. Yeah. But you have to do it for the love of it, which I do. I do love and enjoy it, but I guess stuff like that does help.
Ephraim, what do you do back home for work?
So, for work, I just... I manage an anytime fitness gym back home.
Okay.
Me and my wife, we both co-manage it.
Okay.
So we work together. It works out that way where we don't both have to be at work at the same time.
Nice.
If we want to come home and have a rest, then one will stay at the gym.
Oh, nice.
It kind of works out that way. So I've been working there for maybe about 2 years now.
Okay.
Exactly 2 years. I started working there pretty much as soon as I got out of hospital after my accident, and have been there ever since. And it's been good. I'm able to train there and
yeah, perfect.
Be around people with the same goals as me.
What were you doing a different kind of work before?
So before my accident, I was a personal trainer.
Okay.
And I worked as a personal trainer for a good 5 years.
So you've always been involved in fitness in
areas. I've always been around that bodybuilding scene, fitness, health industry. But it wasn't until my accident I kind of made it a goal of mine to make a career out of it.
Yeah.
So it's been good since then.
Wow. So what's the next competition, or what would you like to do next, if possible?
Yeah, so if possible, the goal with any bodybuilder, really, I'm sure any bodybuilder would have thought of it, is to compete at the Olympia. That's the goal, whether that's in
that's
5 years.
That's the ultimate goal.
Short-term goal for now is because I have to fly to America to compete from now on, the goal for now is just to save up a bit of cash for the next competition, whatever that might be. And then while I'm saving up that cash, just to get bigger, really. The pro guys are a lot bigger than the amateur guys. So, back to what I said before, I don't really like to do things just for the experience. If I'm going to compete, I don't want to go in thinking, oh, I'm just going in to have fun and compete with the pros. I want to go in there to be competitive and to win. So for now, maybe it take a year or two max off. In the meantime, just focus on growing, eating
progress.
Lots of good food. Yeah, progress, that's the goal for now. And then we'll see this time next year how I'm looking.
Yep.
And then maybe compete at the Arnold Classics.
I was going to say, because Arnold Classics is an invitational, which means that they bring you.
Yeah, they do.
That would be good.
I don't know if I'm allowed to say this, but I actually just yesterday got the invite for the next year's Arnold Classics.
In Columbus?
Yeah, in Columbus, Ohio. So the chairman for the pro wheelchair, Nick Scott, he's responsible for the wheelchair guys.
That's awesome.
So I got the invite for that. I'm still deciding whether I want to do it or not. Like I said, I don't want to do it and then just for
I know, experience. But if they're inviting you, then it means you don't have to worry
for sure,
about...
Yeah, for sure. So it's in March next year.
Oh boy.
We'll see how this time in America goes. Maybe I'll put on a bit of size, eating all the good food here. We'll see what happens.
Ephraim, thank you so much for telling your story, man. You have a great attitude. You're a good-looking kid. And I really can appreciate the strength, the mental strength you have, because it's not everybody that will react that way. And I hope you're a lot of people watch this video, this interview, because it's very inspiring.
Thanks, brother.
Yeah, man, it's awesome.
Thank you.
Best of luck to you, and I'm sure that's not the last time we see your face.
Definitely.
Hopefully, you'll be back on Jigadler TV, maybe before the Arnold.
We'll see what happens.
All ripped.
Sounds good.
All right. Thank you so much.
Thank you, brother. Appreciate it.
Hold on. What's your social media? Let's give your stats and everything. And you also told me that you're starting your YouTube channel. So let's talk about that real quick.
So if you're interested, my Instagram is just Ephgudge, E-P-H-G-U-D-G-E. You can find me there. I'm pretty much posting every day. And then I'm trying to get into the YouTube side of things just to kind of get out there a bit more. So just search me up, Ephraim Gudgeon, on YouTube. I'll be in America for the next 2 weeks or so. So I'll be trying to vlog a lot of my food, my training, holiday, stuff like that. So you can find me there.
That's awesome.
Thanks,
thank you so much for coming on.
You too.